So, welcome all. Sorry for the delay. I got a bit lost, but I'm here now. So, welcome all. Today I'm going to talk about creating serverless solutions using Azure Functions. Any of you got experience using Azure Functions or serverless stuff already? Okay, well. That's good because I'm going to recap a bit on what this serverless stuff is again, so you're all a bit up to speed. Because the name is a bit confusing, like you have read probably, because you still need servers in a serverless world, because your code has to run somewhere, of course. You just don't have to care about servers anymore because, well, your code just got uploaded to the cloud and you'll be done with it. This sounds a lot like the PaaS offerings we got a couple of years back because they told us, or at least the big corporations told us, you don't need to care about servers anymore. So serverless is much like the existing PaaS solutions nowadays. The main difference is serverless compute. It's meant for speed and small jobs most of the time. So most existing PaaS solutions at this time aren't fast enough to call it serverless. Sorry. I found a nice quote from Adrian Cockcroft on Twitter, who states, "If your PaaS solution can spin up really fast and run for a very short amount of time, you can call your PaaS solution serverless." I don't fully agree with this quote, but there are of course a couple of characters you can write inside one tweet, so the real definition is a bit more nuanced. Also, this doesn't cover serverless stuff like repositories or infrastructure, which you also still have when using serverless architectures and solutions. One of the things you have to keep in mind in order to keep your serverless compute rather small and fast is, well, actually to keep it small and simple. I'm guessing most of you know this quote or know this line already. Well, this also goes for serverless stuff. When creating your functions, you should keep them rather small in order for them to run pretty fast. And pretty fast. So they can get spin up and spin down rather quickly. So it's in a serverless world, it's perfectly fine to create one function which only does a few model to DTO mapping and just be done with this function and post the DTO to some service bus, for example, or store it inside some repository. This will mean you'll get a lot of functions in the end, but that's a different problem. So now for the real life part of this talk, I've come up with a solution which you could use in your real life as a real life scenario. A couple of months back, I was preparing a different talk about a different subject, of course, and wanted to use custom URLs in this talk because who doesn't like custom URLs? So I created an account at Bitly. Pointed my DNS records to Bitly in order for me to create well nice URLs to big links. This all works perfectly fine. And you also get some nice analytics from Bitly, which is also cool if you want to see how many people have clicked your links. But after a month, I wanted to add some more custom URLs. And they wanted me to subscribe to the enterprise plan of Bitly, which cost about $1,000 per month, which was a bit excessive for me because I don't want to spend that much on smaller URLs. So I thought, what better way to overcome this issue as to create my own URL minification service using, of course, serverless techniques because that's awesome. And how hard can it be creating a URL minifier? You just have two endpoints, one for retrieving the minify URL redirect, and one for creating the URLs. And of course, you need some kind of repository to store it. So what better way to use this as a serverless repository like CosmosDB? One other thing you get for free nowadays with CosmosDB is the access to the change feed, which is rather new. I think it's 2 months old. And what the change feed is or does, it enables you to act upon changes which are happening or have happened inside your repository. So this is cool, of course, because if someone inserts a new minified URL, you can just trigger your Azure functions or an Azure function to do something with it, like updating a cache, for example, or well, do some other stuff with it. So that's pretty awesome, in my opinion. There are some other stuff which you can hook up, on the change feed, but that's not very interesting, at least not for a minifier, URL minifier. So how would how would your solution look like in the traditional non-serverless world? Well, fairly straightforward, in my opinion. You'll have a web app exposing two endpoints, one for retrieving the minified URL and one for creating. And of course, you need to store it, so there's a two-way binding to the CosmosDB. A serverless solution will look fairly similar. You'll have two Azure functions, one for retrieving and one for posting a new minified URL, and of course storing it inside the CosmosDB. So as you can see, the single web application has now been split up into more Azure functions, and both of these Azure functions will be fairly small. One just accesses the CosmosDB, so it does some reading, and one is just creating stuff. So both of them are about, well, I guess 10 lines of code, depending on how you set the width of your lines. And that's about it. Now you could make this a bit more fancy, because we just seen that we can use the change feed, and everybody likes caches nowadays. So what better way to use the change feed and for updating the cache? So this looks a bit more complex already, so it's not something which is the minimum viable product, but it is awesome if you want to leverage the full power of CosmosDB. And of course, an Azure cache like Redis, you can just set it up, and it costs, well, a couple of bucks per month. But it's awesome to create such a thing. Downside is it adds some complexity, and CosmosDB already is pretty fast. I think I haven't seen a query in production which has took longer as 5 milliseconds. So I guess a cache isn't very necessary anymore if you're using CosmosDB. At least not in the solutions I've seen it used. To make this even more of an Azure architecture or a cloud architecture, you definitely need to add some service bus or queuing mechanism, of course. So that's what I did in this picture. Now you have the same design on the retrieval front. I've added a service bus or a queue for creating new minified URLs. So the first function will just use some mapping mechanism to translate the view model to some kind of a DTO, post the DTO on the queue, and I've created a new function which will be triggered when something is added to the queue. So this looks quite interesting, and I guess I will be creating this any time in the near future. But this won't be happening in the upcoming 20 to 30 minutes, because it adds a lot of complexity. So we'll just stick with the minimum viable product, which has two functions and one CosmosDB. One thing you have to remember, like you probably saw on the previous slide, there are a lot of stuff which you can hook up onto. And what makes it easy to work with all of these services is bindings. And in a serverless world, or at least with Azure Functions, bindings are your friend. You don't want to write your own logic to store data inside Cosmos DB or read stuff from your service bus or write stuff on your service bus or maybe even a blob storage. You can just use the Azure Functions runtime for this, create some bindings and be done with it. This will save you a lot of troubles and it's just easy to do. One example of a binding of an HTTP trigger is shown on this slide. First, you have to define a function.json file, and in this JSON file, there's a specific block which is meant to define your bindings. In case of an HTTP trigger, you have to define, well, you want to use an HTTP trigger, of course. Add the route to the HTTP trigger, which is also fairly obvious because how would you enter this trigger? One thing to remember is all of your HTTP routes are getting prefixed with the API, and that's about it for setting it up. You also have to define a method, of course, if you want to get or post or put or delete something to this trigger. In our case, it's just a get method because we want to retrieve the minified URL. And because I think my minifier will become very awesome and everyone in the world will use it, I've set the authentication level to anonymous, so everyone will be able to use it, or at least access this endpoint, this binding. And last but not least, you have to define the name, which will be the parameter inside your Azure function. So in this case, it's called req, which, well, is short for request, I guess. And this will be used, like I said, inside your function. You can also have output bindings. This, of course, is an input binding for an HTTP request. If you want to use output binding, like, for example, writing stuff to Cosmos DB, like we'll be doing in the create function, you have to define some other stuff. Of course, you have to define the name again of your binding and which type it is. And of course, some default values you have to fill out. And because we're connecting to Cosmos DB right now, you have to spy some. You have to define the database and the collection name, and the name of the app setting which holds the actual connection string. That's about it. And one thing you have to remember is defining the direction. If you don't define this, I don't know what happens. But I guess the build will fail, or Azure Functions will see it as an input binding. So just remember to specify out. So this is a lot of JSON, and I'm not a big fan of JSON. I utterly hate it. So I don't recommend in writing this kind of stuff. Just use Visual Studio for creating your Azure Functions, and Visual Studio will take care of writing all of this JSON and writing the function.json file and stuff like that. So you don't have to worry about all of those ugly curly braces. Now we have covered the function.json and how you specify the bindings. You could now start actually write your code, but we won't, because there are still some considerations you have to think about. One of them, which is kind of important, is where will you put all of the code? A lot of tutorials on the internet advise you, or at least they write, just put it all in the Azure portal in the CSX file you get by default, and be done with it, because functions are small, so everyone will be able to understand it. Well, don't do this, because, well, for obvious reasons, you don't have source control, you don't have code reviews, you don't have, well, a lot of stuff. What you could do is use Visual Studio and still place all of your code inside one big massive class, so you have some kind of a got function which does all of the stuff. This will mean you'll end up with a lot of duplication inside your code base. It is a bad thing, well, not per se, because it will enable you to quickly change all of your functions, or at least one function, and be sure all other functions will still work. But if you do this, well, you will probably end up quite cranky someday, if you have to fix some bug which is happening on all of your functions. So code duplication is still something you should avoid, in my opinion. And one other thing you have to think about is what about your favorite libraries? Will you still be using stuff like Autofac, Log4Net, SiriLog, Mediator, stuff like that? I don't think you need all of those libraries anymore. Stuff like Log4Net, which is an awesome logger, of course, but you already get a log writer from Azure Functions for free. So does it make sense to inject a complete logging framework just for your Azure Function because you like Log4Net, for example? Or does it make sense to set up a whole IOC container for one small function? I don't know. It's something you have to consider when creating your Azure Functions or your overall solution, but it's still something that you have to consider, because otherwise you'll end up with, well, a lot of mess, probably. And should you still test? I don't know. Sure, everyone says you should test all of your code and aim for the 100% coverage. Well, I don't agree with the 100% coverage anymore. But should you still test all of your functions? They are pretty small. Like I said, my solution only contains a couple of lines of code. Probably all of the whole flow will fit in your head. Does it make sense to actually test all of this, well, logic? I think it does, especially if you have some business logic inside it. Take, for example, the solution I'm creating over here. When I'm accessing the minified URL foo, I want to make sure I'm reaching to the database and actually get the record foo from it. So it does make sense to still test your business logic, but just be, well, critical about it. I don't think reaching for 100% code coverage is useful, at least not for Azure Functions, the way I've set it up at this moment. But it's something you have to consider when, or at least think about when starting with your Azure Functions, when designing your overall solutions. In short, all of the existing patterns and principles still apply when creating serverless solutions. Take, for example, single responsibility. Your functions should still be small and probably only have one responsibility. Like I mentioned, mapping a view model to a DTO. Well, that's perfectly fine to put this in a function, and it's a rather small code. Interface segregation, why not use it? Because working with contracts is, well, good. So why stop doing this? Also, dependency inversion. Like I mentioned, I'm not a big fan of, for Azure Functions, I'm not a big fan anymore of spinning up IOC containers. But dependency inversion is still a good principle to use inside your code base. For stopping code duplication, you still want to have business layers, data access layers, maybe even so stuff like that for code sharing, especially if you're still sharing your code with some legacy systems like a web application or a web API. So having those layers in place also is still a good idea. So like I mentioned, I'm not a big fan anymore of IOC containers, but I still want to use dependency injection, of course. So what I came up with in my Azure Functions is the following. Just have a default constructor, which I'll be using throughout all of my code. And if I want to specify some special instance of my interface or my dependency, I just have an overload which from which I'm enabled to inject every specific instance of the dependency. So used for testing, of course. I'm not saying this is the best implementation, but it makes the point clear, I guess. Because why set up an IOC container if your function only has five classes inside it, or only uses five classes, and you probably aren't using polymorphism or having multiple implementations of a specific interface inside your Azure function? If you have, you could probably split this up in multiple functions. Well, it doesn't make sense anymore to have different kind of implementations of a specific interface, and therefore you don't actually need an IOC container, in my opinion. So now we're able to actually create the solution. Like I mentioned, we'll be creating two endpoints which hook up to Cosmos DB. If you have Visual Studio 2017 installed with at least update 3, you get a new project template inside it, which is called Azure Functions. And when you create this project, you'll be prompted directly with a new window showing you which triggers you can use. This list is expanding, I guess, every update of Visual Studio. So this is a picture I took a couple of weeks ago, and yesterday I got a new update of Visual Studio, so the list has probably grown a bit by now. First thing I will be creating is the HTTP GET trigger. So this trigger has some parameters. So I've chosen to use the HTTP trigger with parameters and set access rights to anonymous in order to for everyone to be able to access this function. The code looks a bit complex with all of the attributes, but it's actually not that complex. I have some business logic inside it, and the most important thing is the attributes of the rec parameter, which is defining the input for the function.json, which Visual Studio will create for you automatically. So, because, like I mentioned, it's an HTTP trigger, authorization level anonymous. It's a GET. We only want to expose the GET method, and we have to define the route. And if you remember correctly, the earlier scene function.json has the same variables defined. So that's about it of not writing a JSON anymore. There's of course some business logic, which creates a new GET URL handler, retrieves the URL from the Cosmos DB, and finally, when it's done, it creates a redirect response. So the user is redirected directly to the new to the full URL of the minified URL. So that's all there is to it for a GET function. For a create function, you have to define a bit more. First of all, you still have an HTTP trigger because you want to create it, so you have to hook it up. And I want to output my created object to Cosmos DB. So what I've done is I've defined again the stuff which for the request parameter, which will hold the object I'm trying to create, or the minified URL I'm trying to create, and also defined the attributes for the output binding. This will make sure the function.json will have two bindings, one input and one output binding, one for the document DB. And if you see, it's an out dynamic minified URL, so if you have an output binding, you have to define the keyword out in front of it. I've set this to a dynamic, but you could also strong type it with your actual object. It doesn't matter much. Or you could make an out object, which is perfectly fine. We're storing it in a document DB, so you can put in there whatever. Don't forget to actually create the object. So I'm doing some mapping over here, deserializing the JSON I'm getting, and making sure the object is created. And you don't have to do anything more. This is all there is to it. So don't write your own data access to create records in Cosmos DB. Just create an object, and that's all there is to it. And that's all for creating Azure Functions. And if you F5 this solution, it will just work, of course, on your local machine. So now we have to deploy to Azure, of course. There are multiple ways to deploy your Azure functions to Azure. One way is to do right-click deployment, which is something you shouldn't do, of course. So there are only two options left. One is the easy mode, which you can access from the Azure functions portal. And if you log in over there, you see an option called deployment options. And if you click this, you'll be redirected to a deployment blade from which you can select your source code repository. I've used GitHub, and just configure it correctly to use the branch you want to deploy, and everything will get deployed to the slot you're working in. So that's the easy mode. That's something you probably want to do for your side projects, stuff like that. If you're working in a company and want to do something professionally, you want to actually use Visual Studio Team Services, creating a CI build, creating a release pipeline, stuff like that. So I've done this also. In order for you to automatically deploy your Azure functions, first create a CI build. Use the ASP.NET Core .NET Framework template, or .NET Core if you're creating your functions with Core. Because this template already has all the steps predefined with the correct information, the correct parameters. The only thing you have to do is specify which build agent you want to use. I've used the Hosted 2017, so I don't even have to create my own build server or build agent. And I had to point it to the correct solution, which is located in the GitHub. So that's all there is to it for the CI build. Now you head down to the releases tab of Visual Studio Release Management. And over there you add the artifacts which are created from your CI build and add a new environment. I'm using slots for my Azure functions, which I think they're still in preview, but they're working perfectly fine, so just use them if you want. I've created two, or at least I've created one, so I have two slots, the production, the master slot, and one develop slot. And in this develop slot, I have one task based on the deploy Azure app service. And you only have to fill out all of these details, like your MSDN or like your Azure subscription, which service you want to deploy to. And if you're using slots like me, you have to check this box in order for you to select the actual slot you're deploying to. If you want to deploy to the master slot, the production slot, just uncheck this and it will deploy it over there automatically. Also something I discovered, by default this box is filled out with the drop folder of your artifacts, which is fine, I guess, for normal websites. But for Azure Functions, it isn't. You have to explicitly specify the zip file or the package file which holds your code. Otherwise, the whole drop folder will get copied to, the slot you're deploying to, and the actual code isn't extracted. So this is something I discovered after a couple of releases. So it's good to note. And if you're lucky, you'll be seeing a couple of green checkboxes afterwards. So in the first couple of fields for, the reasons I mentioned, and I had some failing code in the template. But now it's working again, luckily. If you head down to Azure Portal again, you'll see both of the functions are deployed now. And you also get a nice message inside the portal stating you have continuous integration and deployment enabled, so you can't do any changes over here. Well, you actually can. You can override this by specifying this in the settings of the function, but, you shouldn't. Since there are still some time left, I've created some bonus slides from something which is still in preview, which is called proxies. Proxies enable you to redirect a request from one endpoint to a different endpoint. And because we're creating a URL minifier service, this actually makes a lot of sense, because like I mentioned, all of the routes are prefixed with API in front of them, and that doesn't make a lot of sense if you're using if you're creating a URL minification service. So you want to keep this as small as possible. So this is where the proxies come in, because now you're enabled to just strip away the API and just use the actual slug you want to access. Something else you might see over here is I'm using a subdomain. That's because Azure Functions don't support A records in your DNS yet. I think this will never happen, because Azure Functions are, well, designed to run everywhere on gazillions of servers. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to point an A record to a specific IP number, because your functions could run on, well, like I said, gazillions of servers. So only CNAME records are supported, so therefore I've used the my subdomain for the minification service. I guess you could solve the subdomain issue with API management, but that's not something I've tried out yet. So how do these proxies look like? Well, actually it's, again, some JSON, because someone probably thought JSON is a good idea. So what you have to do is specify which scheme you want to use, and specify the name of the proxy, and of course the matching conditions. So, because I only want to redirect the GET request, for the GET function, I've specified which method I want to match with, and what how the route looks like. So this way I can do my jdfa.li/foo will get redirected to api/foo. You can actually point this to different Azure functions or completely different endpoints also if you want. They don't have to exist within Azure either. So you can just redirect this to Google, for example, if you want to, which is quite powerful. Still in preview, but very, very useful. That's about it. If you have any questions or want to contact me afterwards, here are some details. The GitHub repository has all of the code which I've used for creating my minification service. It's still ongoing. I want to create some other stuff inside it, but it's a good basic implementation. So thank you all for listening. Someone has a question, maybe, because I still have a couple of minutes left. Yes.
When I created a functions project in Visual Studio in 2017, I was a bit confused by when I enabled the always on option, it would still require me to select a server business plan, so like S1 or S2. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I would like to have nothing to do with servers and memory and CPU. And
yes. So the question is, when I want to create, or when you want to create a new serverless solution using Azure Functions, you had to choose a plan where it runs on, and especially because you wanted to use the always on option. I guess you've used the resource group plan. There are two different plans. One is the consumption plan, which is the actual serverless solution, and one is the resource group plan. And in this plan, you'll be deploying all of your functions to this resource group, which lives in your location. And this plan makes sense if you want to create functions which have to run a bit longer, or if you already have a website and you're pretty sure you don't, you can put your functions in there so it will share the same resources. So if you choose a consumption plan, you only pay for, when a function is called. So if my minification servers will grow quite big and everyone will start using it, I have to pay for each time someone hits the endpoint. And if you're using the resource group plan, you don't have to pay for all of those hits. You just pay for the resource group for the app servers. So that's probably the issue.
Yeah, but a problem with the consumption plan is that you have cold start. So
yes.
It will take sometimes up to 10 seconds before the first function would actually be able to be called.
Yes, I've discovered this also. Which is kind of annoying indeed, especially if you have HTTP endpoints. So that's true, yes. So you have to choose in advance which plan you want to use. Is it good enough? Your functions take a couple of seconds. I've even heard a couple of minutes for some functions to spin up. If your solution is designed for such a delay, it's okay. If not, you should probably indeed use the app servers plan, which has servers inside it, or at least which runs on your server plan. Any other questions? Okay, thank you all for listening.